It is time once again to drop the puck. Another installment of the Edward Jones Faceoff here live on NHL.com. Today's guest played 14 NHL seasons. He racked up 301 career victories between the pipes, and you'll find his name engraved on Lord Stanley's Cup. He is a true New York Rangers franchise icon, none other than the one and only Mike Richter. Mike, thank you so much for joining us today. And Mike, this whole thing was supposed to happen back on Tuesday until old man Winter got a little bit cranky. New Jersey and New York got hit pretty hard. How bad was it up there in your neck of the woods in Connecticut?
Well, I'm happy to say I survived. Thanks for having me on the show. And yeah, better late than never, I guess. It was great. I mean, a little more winter. We had a good dumping. It was over a foot where I am, up by the Westchester Airport. And it's still hockey season, so that's still welcomed.
Yeah, I agree. That as long as hockey's still being played, snow was never a bad thing outdoors. And fans, two ways to get involved. You can fire up the webcam and go one-on-one with Mike Richter today. If you're camera shy, that's okay. You can submit a question through Twitter using the hashtag FaceOffChat. And Mike, with that, we're going to go right to social media. And Mike, let's start with Twitter handle Rangers Raise the Cup, a handle near and dear to you, I'm sure, and many Rangers fans as well. Was there a particular goalie you played against that always seemed to bring out the best in you?
A particular goalie? Yeah, I think everybody has their pride, and when you're playing against the best in the league, you want to show that. And Marty Brodeur was obviously a great player while I was playing. Dominic Hasek, these were particularly great games because you knew he wasn't going to give an inch. Patrick Waugh, all of them. I think you see that all the time. You just watch Connor McDavid and Sidney Crosby play against each other. It was an incredible battle, and sometimes that gets overplayed, but we all have our pride. And so, yeah, we want to show our best when we're playing against the best.
Yeah, no question there. And, Mike, right now, one of many fans lined up to go one-on-one with you. So with that, we're going to bring in our first fan of the day. So, fan, please state your name, your location, and your question for Rangers icon Mike Richter.
Hi, Mike. I'm Chelsea. I'm from New York.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you? I was wondering, what was the best part of celebrating the Stanley Cup championship in 94 after a 54-year drought for the city and the franchise?
Great question. Thanks for it. I think the best thing was immediately you're thinking about the championship in terms of your teammates. They're the guys that have been your family, tight with you all year, the ups and downs, the sweat, the hard parts, and now you're celebrating the culmination of exactly what you set out to do at the beginning of the year and exactly what you've been gunning for your whole career and since you're a little kid. And so that's exactly where you want to be, is celebrating with them. But I think what I didn't realize was what a big part of that family got a little bit larger, and it was the entire city. It was such an event, especially as you mentioned with the 54-year drought history. MSG, you know, with 20,000 people or whatever it was, seemed like a party. It was like you knew everybody, you knew where they sat, you knew the cheers that they're going to do, and it was really intimate somehow with all those people in a big place like New York, all sharing one thing. That surprised me how really important that was to us. It was just an awesome moment. I thought a great reflection of that was when Mess took the cup and brought it over to the boards and just glided it in, and people could reach over and touch it. I mean, that's an iconic trophy. He's an iconic player, and we just won in, you know, one of the best places there is to win in the world. So, yeah, it starts out in that locker room because they're the guys you're going to battle with. But it ends up being that family got really big, but it felt like a tight community. It was an amazing, amazing time.
Yeah, magical moments that Rangers fans will not soon forget. And, Mike, I know that Rangers fans got really sick and tired of the 1940 chants. What about the players?
Yeah, it was interesting. You'd have players coming over here talking about the 1940 chant, and they're going, I just got here a month ago. Why am I being ridiculed for that? But I think Kevin Lowe said it the best, coming from Edmonton and having won, you know, multiple cups there. I said, you know, it's been 54 years. He said, I didn't realize it was that long. And they said, you know, does that weigh on you? Is that a problem? He said, no, man, think of the upside. If we win it, think how much fun this is going to be. And he was exactly right. It made it better because it had been such a hard-fought thing to get. And I also thought one of the funniest things that I've seen, and the Ranger fans are awesome. They have a ton of emotion, but they also have a sense of humor. And when we went to the island, of course, the Islanders were so good in the early 80s, and the Rangers had great battles when JD was in net and all through that time period. And of course, we had won in 94 in the spring, and as soon as we get to training camp and play the Islanders, the first time a goal goes in, and the Ranger fans out Long Island watching the game start cheering 1984. I thought it was so damn funny. I'm like, would you guys get on social media and figure this one out? But and that was before social media. So, yeah, it was a cool thing to be part of, to put an end to that one.
Yeah, it's a great back and forth between Rangers fans and Islanders fans, no question. And, Mike, let's go back to Twitter right now. And this question might make Rangers fans cringe a little bit, but it's worth asking. This one is from Between the Pipes. Did you ever come close in your free agent years to playing for your hometown Philadelphia Flyers?
That's an interesting question. Philly was looking for a goalie the last time I was up for a contract, and it was a possibility. Rangers weren't doing well, and they're saying, do we shift the lineup? What do we do? And interestingly, Cujo was available, Johnny Van Beesbrouck, myself, all around the same age, similar stats, similar size even. And so do you take a gamble and change that up? As a GM, you want to look at your lineup and say, well, what can we do to make ourselves win? The Flyers were looking for a goalie at the time. Obviously, I'd grown up watching them. I had been a fan my whole life until really I was drafted by the Rangers. So it's a possibility. But, man, it doesn't feel too good to try that on. When you are drafted by a team and you've played your whole career there, your allegiance maybe more than you even know at the time. You say, look, this is business. I got to do what I have to do. But it was a very difficult thing, and you try to be respectful of other teams. I was talking to Florida at the time and to Philadelphia, even Vancouver. The kind of the one that nobody anticipated was Toronto coming out and picking up Cujo, and that sort of started a chain reaction. No goalie wants to be without a seat when the music stops, but that sort of moved the dam a little bit. I think Johnny Van Beesbrouck went on to play in Philadelphia. I think he had signed first, and he played very, very well there. So they got a great goalie in him, and I ended up back in New York, which I loved. And you know, the idea is, and I remember Brian saying this, when you're getting up there in the years, and the GM says, well, do you want to be moved? Ray Bourque was going to the Avalanche. It sounds great on paper, but, you know, your allegiance is to your team, and you want to stay and win a Stanley Cup right here in New York. So I was fortunate that I had the opportunity to stay and, you know, maintain a Ranger uniform my whole career.
Well, I can safely say that the thought of you and a Flyers uniform is enough to make Rangers fans lose their lunch. So it's good that that never happened. 14 NHL seasons all with the blue shirts and the Big Apple. Right now, another fan is teed up and ready to go. So, fan, your name, your location, and your question, please, for Mike Richter.
Hey, my name is Mark. I don't know how special it is to have an award named after you for the top Division I goaltender in college, and if you have an idea who you think might win it this year.
Mark, good question. That came to me, it seemed out of the blue. They were looking to really elevate the idea of singling out a goalie and having it similar to a Hobey Baker, and saying this position's different, and so we want to have a special accolade for somebody who is the top goalie. Right off the bat, though, one of the things that was made clear was you were not going to be voting. It's in my name, and I'm humbled by that for sure. I said, are you sure? There's been a couple of good goalies out there. Cujo's one of them, Ken Dryden, that had tremendous college careers. But they wanted an American. They wanted somebody who, both could represent as an award recipient. Academic excellence, on the ice excellence, and community service. And they're pretty rigorous with how they do this. And it's the scouts and the coaches that see these teams and goaltenders play that ultimately decide who is even nominated to get to the final. I can tell you that I will get the final pool and look through it. So far, this is the third year. I've not seen one goalie that's not worthy. These are all tremendous players. College hockey in the United States has had great goalies for many, many years. For decades, it's been a good breeding ground for goaltenders. But right now, the quality of the players is so high across all positions, but goaltenders are phenomenal. In a lot of ways, I'm happy that I'm not. Of course, it would entail me watching every college game, which I don't get to see. But right now, I've been very, very impressed, and the selection committee has been fantastic. And I got to tell you, the last two recipients have been unbelievable players and just great human beings.
Yeah, I don't think you can go wrong with whoever does win that prestigious honor this year. As you said, the quality all across the board seems to go up year after year. Yeah. Mike, right now it is time for the EDJ question of the day, and that is, Mike, you have very strong ties to the NHL's green movement and ecological causes all across the board. Where did that interest begin for you?
Well, I don't think it's a real division from being an athlete to working in this field. At some point, you're going to retire. You go on to your next phase of life. And for me, it's about, you know, trying to achieve excellence in health and performance in a different venue. You know, in some ways, you could say the same venue. These arenas and athletic facilities have some of the best athletes that's ever walked the earth playing in them. But the standards of performance for a lot of the buildings that we have on the commercial, certainly in the sports venues and even residential, are pretty low. And we have, fortunately, we have some really good technologies coming out. My company does a lot of lighting upgrades, LED lighting upgrades. Boring as it sounds, it really increases the performance of buildings. NHL Green Week sounds like, well, you know, how's that really relate? I mean, we're taking food waste from all the 30 arenas right now and feeding homeless people with the food waste. This is prepared, untouched food that normally wouldn't get eaten at a game. Say, you know, a number of hot dogs would be produced at an event at Madison Square Garden. What do you do with it? You throw it in the landfill. It's going to create methane gas and a lot of basic rubbish. And now they're taking that and saying, well, this is actually still clean, good, untouched. We'll feed it to somebody who needs it. 120,000 meals have been prepared, and hundreds of tons of food have been kept out of the landfill. So when you're talking about this, I almost encourage people, put the political crap aside. Put even words like sustainability and green and tree-hugging aside. This is about better performance all around, whether it's water, energy, or waste. And the NHL, I can tell you, I've been in a lot of these where the nexus of sports and the environment meet, is an absolute leader. Nobody does it better. Gary Bettman and the green team headed by Omar Mitchell, Paul LaCaruba, unbelievable what they've done. So they're ahead of the class right now, and it's a great thing, and I'm very proud of that.
Yeah, it goes without saying, a tremendous cause, and one that I'm sure you're very proud to be involved with, no question. Mike, right now we go back to the webcam. Another fan is teed up and ready to go. So your question, please, your name and your location for Stanley Cup champion Mike Richter.
Hey, guys. My name's Tim Kenny. I'm from Long Island. My question is, Mike, in the NHL today, is there any goaltender that reminds you of yourself? And if there is, why is it and who is it?
That's a good question, Tim. Thanks for being on. You know, I would love to compare myself to any goaltender now, because I think, you know, all 30 of the starting goalies and all 30 of the backups are phenomenal players. I said this about college hockey. The quality of the competition is very, very high. I don't think the NHL's ever been better. And at no position has it grown more than the position of goaltender. They're well trained, they're well coached, they understand the game better than ever. These guys are big, strong, fast, very specific in how they train. Before, it was getting shape and play as part of the team. Goaltenders have a specific responsibility, specific position, and they need specific training, and that's been the case, and you see it out in the ice. And how do you measure that? It's by consistency. I mean, look, the guy that I'm a big fan of is Henrik Lundqvist here in New York. I think the guy's great. Obviously a different style than me. Bigger, better looking, maybe quicker. But I will tell you, I love the way he approaches the game, and that is something that doesn't seem to change. You have to be a professional in order to be successful in this league. It's very, very competitive, and I really appreciate the way he approaches the game with the level of demand that he has on himself. And I do feel I had that as a young kid and as a pro playing as well. So I relate to very much. But man, oh man, I look at these guys. I play men's league now, and I come down high school goalies, I see no net to shoot at. These dudes are incredible. So I'm happy to be compared with any of them.
Yeah, you mentioned King Henrik. A little banged up right now is the King, but hopefully he gets healthy and gets back in time for the playoff push, as the Rangers will no doubt be part of the 8-team playoff mix in the Eastern Conference. Mike, right now the fans are coming fast and furious. Another one is ready to go. So, fan, your name, your location, and your question, please, for Mike Richter.
Hi, Mike. It's Matt from New York. Big fan. Thank you for everything you've done. Just curious, who do you think was the toughest skater that you had to go against in your time?
Man, oh man, great question, Matt. Thanks for being on. Look, Wayne Gretzky, obviously his numbers speak for themselves. He made everybody on his team better. Mark was a mess, was a force of nature on that team. But a guy that we saw a lot because he was in our division, you know, that combination of Mario Lemieux and Jaromir Jagr. And Jagr, I don't know, that was like 40 years ago and he's still playing. But Lemieux in particular had such good hands, had that sense of vision that Wayne has or Brian Leetch had as a defenseman. But just the physical strength that he had, 6'6". Like, he is not going to go out there and beat anybody up in a fight. That's not his game. But you couldn't take the puck off of him. He understood the game well. There's a guy 6'6" who's the leading scorer in the league, and he'd somehow become invisible when he's in your zone and find a way to get the puck open to him. And we had great defensive players like Jan Eriksson, when I first came in the league, whose job was, you know, marry that guy, stay on him. And Jan would be all over him. And then Mario would find a way to get one shot off, and it might be the game tire or the game winner. Extraordinary competitor, physically gifted, and just a very rare talent. And Mario, he was fun to watch. It's just too bad that, you know, he had as many injuries and sicknesses as he did, but he's been amazing, amazing for our game.
Yeah, no accident that his nickname, of course, was Super Mario for all those years. One of the true all-time greats in NHL history. Mike, we're going to take this one home with a great question from Twitter. This is from MTR Bates, and he says, hi, Mike. It is Mike from Milwaukee. Do you miss State Street Brats? And do you wish you were there for the game tonight for the Badger game? Because, of course, March Madness commences today. Number 8 seed Wisconsin faces number 9 Virginia Tech tonight. What do you think? Do you wish you were there?
Oh, man, I miss the brats, and I miss Wisconsin. My wife was born in Milwaukee. I'm a proud Badger. I love the place. And my roommate from New York, Tony Granato, is now the head coach of the hockey team. So, yeah, we're very excited for the Red, whether it's basketball, football, or hockey. But, yeah, I'll be watching that game. It's great. I've got a young boy at home who's really into it, and I'm indoctrinating him. So, yeah, go. Thanks for the tweet, and go Badgers.
Yeah, the Badgers came oh so close to winning it all a couple years ago. Maybe they've got another magical run in them here in 2017. And, Mike, that's going to wrap it up today. It was a blast for us, and we hope that you had fun. So thank you so much for coming on.
Hey, thank you for having me. That was fun. Take it easy, guys.
All right. New York Rangers icon Mike Richter joining us here on this installment of the Edward Jones Face-Off on NHL.com. Join us again next time. Take care.